Clúid, Fiona Byrne, Clúid CEO Brendan Gorman, our Octus colleagues. I know Marnie Sullivan was here earlier. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm very pleased to be here this morning to launch this important piece of research commissioned by Clúid, Changing Perceptions, Stigma and Social Housing in Ireland, carried out by Dr. Michelle Norris, Dr. Michael Byrne and Anna Carnegie of the School of Social Policy and Social Justice at UCD. And I want to really thank you for this piece of work. Not only, I think, will it be impactful for the plans that many approved housing bodies have for the future, like Clúid and others, but also it will impact and encourage us as policymakers in government to be able to take note of it and make sure that it's factored in the context of the work that we're doing. So I welcome the report. The report finds that while stigmatisation of social housing tenants unfortunately does exist, planned measures can be taken to address stigma in existing developments and to avoid it attaching to new developments. The report provides support for my department's policy that social housing should be delivered not by way of large mono-tenure estates, but by ensuring as far as possible that new social housing is provided in mixed-tenure developments, properly integrated with private residential schemes, which would foster sustainable communities. This is the overriding approach which we are taking in the development of new social housing units under the Rebuilding Ireland Plan. And can I really emphasise this point? There's been a lot of talk about the government's housing plan, some of the critical, some of the positive over the last year or so. And you know, we are committing to spend 5.3 billion euros on adding an extra 47,000 houses to our social housing stock. And people like Dolly and others will know the detail of that. But actually, the most ambitious element of that housing and social housing plan is around mixed tenure developments. To move away from the approach that was taken in the past, whereby we designate portions of cities and towns because they happen to be land owned by local authorities, and we just fill them with social housing estates as we can afford to do it. And it gets done on a phased basis. So 20 are built, and then another 20, and then 30, and then 40, as the state can afford to do that. The consequence of that is that we're not planning for large communities that are being built and developed. A part of which is actually building the houses, but also the other support facilities, whether that be sporting, leisure, open space, community facilities, or whatever. And layered on top of that, which I think is a design challenge more than anything else, the way to deal with stigmatization, or the way in which people perceive somebody because of the address and where they come from, is to actually integrate communities in a much more ambitious way than we have attempted to do in the past. So that people grow up in diverse communities. And when you drive into a housing estate, it's not obvious which houses are social housing, which houses are private housing. And that, by the way, we're not reinventing the wheel here. This is doable, it happens in many other countries. I lived in Brussels, for example, for a number of years, in a large apartment complex. And quite a number of the apartments in that complex were social housing, and some of them were supported private rental housing. And we didn't know the difference. And we shouldn't know the difference. That's the whole point of proper mixed tenure, diverse mixed communities growing up together, where we try to undermine the stigma that some people may have in relation to social housing estates. And the disadvantage and false perceptions that are allowed to develop as a result of that. And so the government's vision for social housing is very clear. As I said, it sets out an ambitious plan for delivery for new supply between now and 2021, which will deliver across a series of methods from new builds to acquisitions to very long-term leasing, of nearly 50,000 extra social housing units, 47,000 to be exact. Success will require a blended delivery that involves harnessing the best housing possible, given stock availability, and achieving the best value for money within the financial resources available to government. A range of delivery mechanisms are operating in parallel. This is about building, buying, leasing, and maximising the use of existing properties, both rental and vacant. But that 47,000 figure does not include HAP tenancies or rental amounts, just to be clear. This is new addition to the stock. It's about 140,000 social housing units available to the state at the moment, and we need to add to that significantly. So we're going to add about 30% to the social housing stock in 5 years. That's a pretty ambitious target that we're setting for ourselves. I've announced a range of new schemes and delivery mechanisms to achieve this in terms of adding to the new stock. For example, in the last few days, we've been finalising things in relation to a repair and leasing scheme, which will bring at least 3,500 currently vacant units into social housing use over the next number of years. This week, Minister Donoghue and I announced a €226 million investment by way of local infrastructure that is going to trigger and support new housing infrastructure development. It'll be roads, bridges, drainage projects, and so on across local authority levels, local authority areas, that will free up development and facilitate the delivery of about 23,000 new housing units by 2021. The majority of those will be private, but there will be a significant number of what are called Part 5 social housing units, which will be 10% of every private development from now on. There was a time when Part 5 facilitated a buyout clause, essentially, for developers, whereby they could give money and then they wouldn't have to build social housing as part of their developments. That's over. There's a line in the sand now, it's very clear. If you're building houses, 10% of them have to be social houses. Full stop. No exceptions. And that is what we will insist on. And in fact, many of those social housing developments will go way beyond 10% in terms of Part 5. Because it actually suits some developers to be able to do deals with local authorities to get paid early for houses. And it helps the cash flow for the developer as well in terms of financing the projects that they have to finance. In addition to the effective Part 5 mechanisms to deliver social housing as part of the next 10-year integrated development, my department is also working with local authorities to develop appropriate delivery mechanisms for larger scale mixed tenure developments. I want to give the example, and there are a number of people in this room who have been very helpful on this, of the agreement, the political agreement in relation to Redenby Gardens. While Dublin City Council is currently engaged in progressing a large mixed tenure residential development in a very attractive part of the city, we will see social, rental, affordable rental and privately owned houses developed together as part of that overall project. So there is an initial social housing project for 56 units, but the rest of that site, which will be another over 500 units, will be a split between private housing, affordable rental accommodation and social housing. And that split will be roughly 50% private, 30% social housing and 20% affordable rental. And I think that is the kind of mixed tenure development that can give us very different types of results in the future to what we've had in the past on sites like Redenby Gardens. In the context of the delivery of the targets for social housing, I'm very clear that approved housing bodies have a very significant contribution to make. Their experience in working within communities, supporting households with specific needs, including homeless households, being good landlords, as well as procuring and managing renovation works, working together with local authorities to turn around unfinished housing estates and to make use of the NAMA portfolio of assets will be critical to achieving success. Our estimation is that approved housing bodies have the capacity to contribute around a third of the 47,000 new social housing units that are targeted over the period from now until 2021. To support this, I've secured almost €1 billion of capital funding so that approved housing bodies can build and acquire new social housing units. This funding will be made available over the lifetime of the Rebuilding Ireland Plan through the Department's Capital Assistance Scheme, or CAS, as some of you will know it, and the Capital Advance Leasing Facility, which is known as CAF. Another almost €1 billion in current funding under the Social Housing Current Expenditure Programme has been secured for the cost of payment and availability agreements and leases over the lifetime of the action plan, which some of you will be very familiar with. The government is also committed to a range of other structural funding and policy supports to increase the delivery by approved housing bodies like Clúid. These supports include an innovation fund, multi-year financing, a one-stop shop for procurement, advice and support, the establishment of a regulator for the sector on a statutory basis, and this will also be a key step in terms of a continued evolution and rationalisation across the AHB sector. I note that Clúid, our host today, is one of the largest approved housing bodies operating in the country, with almost 6,000 units, providing homes for individuals and families right across the country. Clúid, like other AHBs, has embraced our ambitious targets head-on and is working hard across the country to build a strong pipeline for the construction and acquisition of new, high-quality social homes. I'm also pleased that my department has been in a position to support Clúid in its work over the years through the Capital Assistance Scheme and the CAF Scheme and the Capital Loan and Subsidy Scheme. Funding in excess of €38 million has been approved by my department for Clúid under the CAF Scheme for the provision of over 200 units since 2014. I also note that over €17 million has been advanced to Clúid under the CAF Scheme since 2009. The Capital Advanced Leasing Facility, the CAF Scheme, since 2009. This funding represents 640 units which have been delivered and are operational, and an additional 950 units which have been approved for funding and are in the pipeline. So there's a lot of people working hard here to try and deal with the housing shortage, and it's a big housing shortage. And we will continue to do that and to put a lot of public money into it. Clúid are also working closely with the Housing Agency in the context of the agency's acquisition of portfolios of vacant properties. This collaboration will be critical if we are to achieve the accelerated delivery of new social homes, in particular in the Dublin area, where we know there is an acute need to address unacceptable levels of family homelessness, and where we also know that there's a lot of vacant properties that we can use if we can get our hands on them. I fully anticipate that Clúid will continue to play a vital role in the provision of social housing across the country. As I said at the outset, today's report is a very welcome confirmation of the policy that we're looking to pursue in government at the moment, and is fully consistent with the international experience. But it's good to have this confirmation in terms of Irish examples and specific research. The report also identifies important lessons to inform layout and detailed design in pursuing this policy, and in part for local authorities assessing the merits of particular proposals for social housing under the Part 5 process. Particular points of interest that I want to highlight include even in mixed tenure developments, there's a strong sense that physical separation and different tenure types is not advisable, and there is a preference for dispersal of social housing units across the development. So what's being pointed to there, and what I'm also insisting on where we can, is that when you have a development that's being developed, the days of putting all the social houses into one corner and then creating some kind of buffer strip between there and all the private houses that you're looking to sell in the market, we need to end that. And we need to have proper integration in terms of design, whereby the housing estate works in terms of proper integration, and you don't have all of the social housing tenants in one corner because there may be some perceived interest in selling the other properties more easily if you do that. We need to pepper them around the estate, essentially. And I think that will create a lot more integration and again deal with some of the stigma, which is very unfair in the context of many social housing tenants. Secondly, there should be equality of access to the specific amenities in a development, avoiding locating the social housing in a less desirable part of the scheme, or with unequal access, for instance, to shared parking facilities. So these are practical design issues and there's no excuse not to get them right in the future. The provision and design of common areas and play areas are important considerations also in mixed tenure developments, so that we're serious about real integration. The traditional community centres properly provided in social housing areas are unlikely to attract privately owning or private residential tenants, and of more attraction are more specialised facilities such as gyms and creches and so on. And I do think in a lot of the bigger new developments that we're building, we're looking to build communities now. So that will involve areas for leisure, for support, for childcare, and so on. And those facilities need to be shared facilities for everybody where possible. A range of social housing provision must, in itself, be more varied rather than the traditional three-bedroom catering for families and children. What people are pointing to here is that traditionally, social housing has simply been provided on the basis of building housing estates of three-bedroom MEDs, essentially. When the vast majority of people looking for social housing were families of three or four people, two parents and two or three children, that was understandable. Now about 44% of people in social housing lists are actually individual people on their own. We are going to see in the next 20 years a doubling of our population over the age of 65. So how are we designing that into our social housing solutions? Creating real integration? Are we building houses specifically for elderly people? Because we need to be. Because we're going to have over 1 million people by 2040 over the age of 65. And we don't want people, and people will be demanding independent living for much longer periods. People will want to essentially move and downsize from family homes to units that are specifically designed for them and their needs. And that needs to be factored into social housing provision also, so that we not only get mixed tenure, mixed income levels in the same estate, but we also get different age types, so that we don't have a development for old people down the road, while we have a development for families in a different part of the town. We need integration. As I say, not only in terms of social housing tenants and private housing owners, but we also need integration in different age types as well. Whilst many of these provisions are informally encouraged by my department in its review of social housing proposals by local authorities and in the review of Part 5 proposals, it's of great assistance to see these approaches essentially being supported through good quality research. The report concludes that the stigmatisation of social housing tenants does arise and can be a serious concern for some residents of social housing. And I know, and I hope this doesn't sound patronising, but I know, like, when people look at me, right, and they hear me talking about social housing and stigmatisation and social disadvantage, some people say, well, what would he know about that? In terms of the house that he grew up in, and so on. And, maybe that's a fair enough comment. But my job as a policymaker and as a government minister is to look at the evidence that's there in front of me. And to look at areas in towns and cities where we see genuine social disadvantage in relation to education attainment, in relation to unemployment levels, and ask the question, why is that? And how can we help to fix it over time? And that's my job, and that's what I'm going to do. And a big part of fixing that, or at least trying to over time reduce that disadvantage, is about dealing with stigmatization, which is there whether we like it or not. And it frustrates and annoys people sometimes to even talk about it. But it's there. And we need, in terms of policy and in terms of how we spend our money, to insist on design solutions, mixed tenure solutions, and a changing approach towards social housing that creates a much more normalised and relaxed relationship between families that need a bit of assistance from the state in terms of their long-term housing needs versus families that are able to afford to buy their own home. And people in between in terms of affordable rental projects and so on. And that's what we're going to try and do. To everybody here who's helping us in those efforts, I want to thank you. In particular to everybody from Clúid, but also those of you from other approved housing bodies. You're a big part of what we're trying to do at the moment. It is going to take us a little bit of time to change the approach. Local authorities are used to essentially getting a site, going through a tendering process to get a builder in, and building 50 social housing units. And there you go. Right? A lot of projects over the next couple of years will be that traditional approach. But over time, we need to change the way in which we do this. On a lot of private estates, we need to do deals with builders to get more than 10% social housing in many of the private housing estates that are being built. And in many of the social housing estates that are being built, we need to be inviting in private housing as well, so that we are forcing integration both in social housing projects and in private housing projects. And over time, we will see the lines blurred a lot between where social housing areas begin and end versus private housing elements. So we have some good examples of how we can make that work. We're looking to develop some projects that we can all point to and say, well, look, if we can do it in O'Debney Gardens, if we can do it in St. Teresa's Gardens, if we can do it in terms of how we redevelop Dominic Street, if we can do it in Oscar Traynor Road, whatever these projects are, well, then that can be replicated in other parts of the country as well. So my job is to try and lead by example, to make sure that I fight for resources around the cabinet table when we need it. But just, you know, on an upside, like the Department of Housing is the only department that has an agreement in government on multi-annual funding for nearly €5.5 billion over the next 5 years for social housing. And now it's up to us to make sure that we spend that properly and that we try to counteract some of the genuine issues that you have reported on the back of good research in terms of how we respond to stigma. Stigma sounds kind of theoretical, but what it leads to is actually the problem. If we are not allowing young people in particular to fulfill their potential because of the stigma around where they come from that is held by other people who may be future employers or educators or whatever, then we're letting people down. So that's why this report is important, and that's why it's a privilege for me to be here to make a contribution this morning. So thanks very much for taking the time to listen.